This is Josh with 9 Hole Reviews here for MidwayUSA, and today we're going to be talking about mils versus MOA, which we shoot, why, and some considerations you might have as you're getting into long-range shooting. Let's get right into it. Mils and MOA. The baseline we need to set here is that both of these things are just units of measure, or at least within the context of our conversation. So again, they are, as the same thing as saying, inches or centimeters, we can use mils or MOA. And it's more efficient for us to use this talking about the vertical and horizontal dispersion of where a projectile is going, landing, or needs to be held over for because of how mils and MOA are able to gradiate out over distance. So let's talk about what the conversions look like really quickly, and then we'll get into some of the pros and cons of both systems. So one MOA is equal to just over 1 inch at 100 yards. And then it scales as you go further out. So one MOA, 1 inch at 100. One MOA, 2 inches at 200. 3 inches at 300, 4 inches at 400, so on and so forth. Again, all one MOA, but what that gradiates to over distance changes in terms of actual empirical measure. Now, on the mil side, one mil equals 3.6 inches at 100, and again, doubles as you go out and scales as you go out. Now, right on its face, that sounds to me like MOA is easier to grasp and wrap your head around because everything is just simply increasing in a very understandable cadence, whereas on the mil side, you're doubling these numbers with fractions and decimals and things get a little bit messy. 3.6, 7.2, so on and so forth. Whereas I can go 1, 2, 3, 4 inches is 1 MOA at 1, 2, 3, and 400 yards. So for me, as a new shooter who is getting into understanding how bullet drop and how dope tables and how these units of measure work within the context of shooting at range and compensating for holdovers, I found it easier to use MOA at first because I had it in my mind that I needed to be able to convert from inches to MOA and back. And that's something we're gonna get to in just a minute. Talk more about that specifically. So in our minds, MOA, at least for North American shooters who are used to inches and empirical, We tend to see that MOA is easier to understand. Now, MOA also has a finer adjustment strategy or system within it. So most precision optics allow you to adjust in quarter MOA clicks. So again, 0.25 MOA or 0.25 inches at 100 yards. So as I'm zeroing my rifle, I can have very finite adjustments. Contrast that against mil systems. On the mil systems, the finest you'll get is 0.1 mils. 0.1 mils is actually 0.36 inches, again at 100, and so you can actually not refine your zero as well on a mil-based system as you can on an MOA-based system. Whether or not that tenth of an inch is actually relevant in achieving your zero, well, that's another question altogether. All right, so when it comes down to really sort of beginning to understand how the units of measure correlate with units of measure we are used to, i.e. inches, and drawing a zero and refining that zero, MOA tends, in our mind at least, to have the advantage. But where we start to see that shift where mil gains the advantage is through the actual practical use of pressing the rifles out to distance and actually having to compensate for the holdovers or for both elevation and for windage. And let me explain why. So on the mil system all operates within units of measure divisible by 10. So your normal mil optic will have something like, let's call it 12 to 15 mils of vertical travel within the optic plus whatever is in the reticle. And that is then divided by 10, so you'll have zero as your zero point, so zero mils as your zero point, and then you start to stagger out by 0.1 mil increments. Again, everything divisible by 10. So 0, 0.1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 1.0 mils, 1.1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 2, 0.0 mils, so on and so forth. This keeps the scale of the numbers that you have to try to work with and remember as it relates to your dope tables or what your actual elevation drops are. It keeps them relatively simple to remember because you're usually working in basically standard 0 to 10 range with simple 1/10 decimals in between. So where this is really effective and shows itself exceptionally well is with how you can round some of these numbers a bit to shoot sort of torso-sized targets, for example. And we'll use a 5.56 precision carbine or SPR style gun as an example here. If we zero them at 100, that's 0 mils of adjustment. And as we go to 200, it's about 0.5 mil. 300 is 1.0 mils. 400 is about 2. 500 is about 3. 600 is about 4, 4.5. So between 0 to 600 yards, we can sort of snap call what our mil come ups are, and they're just in stepped out 1, 2, 3, 4 increments. Very easy to remember and to understand. Now, when we look at how that translates over to an MOA perspective, because the scalability of the MOA unit of measure is different and it is more refined, you need to think about this, that you need more MOA than you do mils to reach a certain distance. So again, we used 500 is about 3 mils of vertical adjustment that's required to land our 5.56 77 grain projectile on target. Well, in the MOA world, that's like 11 MOA, maybe a little less. So it's 10.75 MOA. And then if I look at the next step down to 400, well, that's actually about 7.25 MOA. So it's not as simple and digestible of a nice, easy stepped out scale. Now, don't get it mistaken. If you have worked with MOA, you can be extremely effective because you'll know what the scalability of these things are. But in our mind, the mil system is more conducive to being able to memorize and then translate that memorization of a dope table into actual practical adjustments on range. Additionally here, the mil reticles that you see are, in our opinion, usually a bit cleaner and easier to track and identify than their MOA counterparts. Now again, this isn't always universally true. It's something to look at when you're actually selecting your specific optic. But for the most part, because MOA is more refined and can be more refined than mil, as we talked about within the context of zeroing, there tends to be more hashes. The reticles tend to be busier as a general rule when it comes down to looking at MOA reticles, whereas mil reticles usually have a very easy to follow 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, 0.8, 1, or 0, 0.5, 1 style of adjustment within the reticle that again is very conducive to actual practical use when it comes down to being quick and effective on target. And additionally here, mil tends to have the advantage when it comes down to being able to actually range targets. So if you know the approximate width of a target, you can use a formula within mils to quickly range that target, or at least be able to get a pretty good idea of how far away a target is, and then utilize that with your, again, sort of more practical, faster-based dope assessment to be able to put a firing solution together for that target. All right, so let's circle back to that initial advantage that we talked about for MOA, which is the ability for somebody who is new to this unit of measure to hop in and understand it more simply than mils, since it's a 1-to-1 inch to MOA relationship at 100 yards. A lot of this comes back to this nagging desire that many new shooters, myself included, back when I was learning how to use these systems, where we have this burning desire to put things into context that we understand. So I would shoot a group and I would go measure the group in inches and then convert it to MOA. And again, if I was shooting at 100, that was really easy. It was 1-to-1. And if I was trying to use mils, it was like, now I'm having to divide out the distance of this group off of the zero by 3.6 to find out what my mil conversion is. And they made it cumbersome. But as soon as you realize that you don't need to do that at all, and you can do everything you need within the context of either MOA or MIL, suddenly it completely negates that advantage, right? So MILs are just as easy to utilize when it comes to measuring and zeroing your rifle, because you can shoot a group and then just simply lay your reticle over the target where your point of aim was and where the group was, and count off the number of hash marks in that, in terms of mils, dial that onto the turrets, reset your zero, shoot a group, and you will be dead center in the middle of the bullseye. Or maybe you can refine it again from there. But the point here is, as soon as you stop trying to talk about any of your bullet drop or your wind correction or anything along those lines, your zero, in terms of inches, and you simply talk about it within terms of mils, you can do everything so much easier. And so we here at Nine Hole, as you can tell, we're big fans of the mil system. But the most important piece here is just pick one of the systems and go with it. So if you have already learned MOA, don't feel the need to go and switch to mils because of what we're talking about here. If you're already practiced and sufficient and proficient with MOA, keep training with it. Ultimately, the biggest thing here is to just pick one and move away from trying to think about things within the context of inches. Now, one last consideration is if you are part of a team or you have a partner or a hunting buddy or a range friend that you go out and shoot with frequently, a shooter spotter type setup that you guys do, you should try to learn the system that they are learning as well or that they're already proficient with. Reason being, then you're talking the same units of measure. Things are way easier that way. So I actually learned MOA. Henry utilized mils, and when we came together for the nine hole show, I had to learn mils. But now that we both talk and operate in mils, things are much easier. So with all that said, we hope that this has been a helpful explanation for you as you look to choose either mil or MOA. And until next time, we'll see you on the range.